Good morning. Welcome all to worship this morning here at Union UCC. Whether you are with us in the sanctuary here or watching our live stream or catching us at another point this week, we give God thanks for you and we are holding you all in our prayers. When you arrive at church, please remember to visit our welcome tables to pick up a bulletin and to drop off your offering envelopes. We ask that you keep in your prayers Chester Bostick, who's in the hospital this week, and also keep in your prayers Lisa Minnick. She is listed in the hospital, but she has since come home, but extra prayers for healing could never hurt. See your bulletin about the news of Reverend Patient's retirement at the end of December. So because of that, we're trying to shower her with gifts and cards showing our appreciation of her ministry here with us. You can send those cards to Donna Chrisman by November 15th. There's a whole bunch more details in your bulletin about that. And we will hold a special celebration of Patient's ministry on December 5th. United Way has kicked off its campaigns, and it's time to make your designations. If your company participates and matches funds, this is a great time to add Union UCC to your giving. So work with your HR or personnel departments to include us in this year's United Way campaign, and we thank you in advance for your generous support of this.
We were invited by Heidelberg Church to participate in a mission opportunity. The folks at Kids Peace are looking for luggage that is used, things like duffel bags, small suitcases, larger suitcases, so that when kids move from one place to another, whether it's out of home or to Kids Peace or to a foster home, that they have some help to do that. So if you have those kind of items that are clean and usable, you can bring them to church during the week and put them on the porch, or on Sundays you can bring them here and we'll put them in Memorial Hall. And they'll be delivered on your behalf. So thank you for doing that. You'll see there's an insert inviting you to Santa's Attic on November 21st and 28th. We are not collecting new things, so do not bring more books or things. We have to get rid of everything that's been stored here for the last 2 years. So we are thankful for the volunteers that are willing to do that. And so if you'd like to come and shop on those days, we'd love to have you do that. Thank you so much. And it also is a good time to be able to start picking up your offering envelopes for the new year, and also the Salvation Army tree tags to shop for kids and families. Tomorrow night is our next Faith on Tap gathering at Cornfinds. You can see the sign-up genius information in your bulletin. And see your bulletin, your newsletter, website, Facebook page for more details about all of these ways to participate, as well as many more. So. Thank you and welcome to worship. Let's enjoy our first hymn.
Help us to throw off the cloaks of our limited imaginations that we might find ourselves forever in your presence. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
And they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up. He He is calling you. So throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. Then Jesus said to him, what do you want me to do for you? The blind man said to him, my teacher, let me see again. Jesus said to him, go, your faith has made you well. Immediately he regained his sight and followed him on the way. This is the end of the scripture reading. May God's word be a lamp to our feet and a light for our path.
This is Job's reading from Job 20:42. Then Job answered the Lord, I know that you can do all things and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Who is this that hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore, I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me, which I do not know. Hear, and I will speak. I will question you, and you declare to me. I have heard of you by the hearing of the ear, but now my eyes see you. Therefore, I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. And the Lord restored the fortunes of Job when he had prayed for his friends. And the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. Then there came to him all his brothers and sisters and all who had known him before. And they ate bread with him in his house, and they showed him sympathy and comforted him for all the evil that the Lord had brought upon him. And each of them gave him a piece of money and a gold ring. The Lord blessed the latter days of Job more than the beginning. And he had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, and 1,000 donkeys. He also had 7 sons and 3 daughters. He named them first Jemima, the second Keziah, and the third Karen Hapuk. In all the land, there were no women as beautiful as Job's daughters, and the father gave them an inheritance along with their brothers. After this, Job lived 140 years and saw his children and his children's children 4 generations. And Job died old and full of days. So that was our second lesson for today. I'm not going to lie. I have more days than I want to admit that I wish I could have, and that each of us could have, a day where Jesus comes to us, appears to us, and says, what would you like me to do for you, Chris? And he listens to my answer, and then he responds like he did for Bartimaeus today. In today's gospel from Mark, we meet Bartimaeus, a person who is blind, and Bartimaeus hears that Jesus is coming to town and starts to look for him and follow him and starts shouting, Jesus, have mercy on me. And at first, a crowd tells Bartimaeus to be quiet, to go away. And Jesus instead agrees to meet him and then asks, Bartimaeus, what do you want me to do for you? And Bartimaeus says, I want to see again. And that's what happens. Jesus heals him. Now, in contrast to those who wanted to keep Bartimaeus quiet, Jesus kind of says, no, come here. Let me hear what you have to say. And not only does he hear him, he receives him and honors his request. When Jesus declares Bartimaeus healed, the reciprocity continues. Their relationship continues. And Bartimaeus is not only healed physically, but spiritually and emotionally, because Bartimaeus then decides to become a follower of the way, a follower of Jesus. His healing is whole and complete, his whole life. And then we have the second reading from Job. We might call this sort of the Eeyore person of the faithful living. And I'll confess again that sometimes I sound a little bit like Job does, complaining, whining, maybe even getting a little mad or angry at people or at God. And throughout the book of Job, we would hear all of these difficulties that he endures throughout his life. And he doesn't get helpful advice or support from his friends either. And he wants a break from it. And so he goes to God for some clarity and direction. He's been crying out to God basically through the whole book, you know, looking for answers and wondering where God is in the midst of it all. And Job says things to God like, "Then call, and I will answer, or let me speak, and you reply to me." Or he says, "Oh, that I knew where I might find God, that I might come even to his dwelling." And another line, "Oh, that I had one to hear me." Like, almost sounds like Shakespeare, doesn't it? It's just so dramatic and so deep with struggle and heartache. I don't want to minimize everything that Job went through, because it was pretty horrible. But doesn't sort of his honesty and his kind of rare prayers, open-hearted prayers, reflect kind of how we might feel sometimes? And maybe why we connect to someone like Job? While God's ways have been mysterious to Job, God didn't remain silent forever. And in the chapters leading up to today's lesson, God basically says to Job, "I'm here, and I've been here all along." Now, if we read the beginning of the book of Job, we will hear that Job basically loses everything. He loses his possessions, his home, his wife, his children, and he is faced with a lot of suffering. And in many ways, he has every right to be mad. He has every right to be confused and to be struggling and to whine and complain. The story of Job and his friends is that of people trying to put together the pieces of a puzzle of life and faith. And so Job is going to God with these big questions, especially this sort of why question. Why is this happening to me? Why does it happen to anyone? Why now? All of those questions that maybe we've been tempted to ask ourselves. But some of the pieces weren't being given to Job and his friends, and so they couldn't figure out Job's suffering or how to solve the puzzle. The journey given to Job was not to understand God and God's ways. The journey, or the assignment given to Job, was to continue the journey and to respond faithfully to God, even through all of those questions and uncertainties, as a way to continue to look for the answers to this puzzle. This week's scripture readings are filled with good news, if we can hear them and hold on to them. Good news that fortunes are restored, that Jesus can save and heal, that sight is restored, and that God is with us through it all. Yet just below the surface of all of this good news are also some pretty big questions. What does the story of sight restored for someone like Bartimaeus, who's considered to be changed and transformed into a faithful person, what does that mean for us when we look for healing and we are faithful, but we don't get the healing that we hope for or hope for others? And Job's story makes us ask, why is there suffering in the first place? Why do bad things happen to good people? Why do good things happen to bad people? Our questions don't always get an answer, and I wish I could tell you, here are all the answers you're looking for today. But instead, what I'm offering to you is the process, the journey, to stay on the path. Our questions will lead us to deeper meaning and hopefully more a sense of purpose and calling. Hopefully, through studying the scriptures and hearing the stories of other faithful people who share our questions through the years of today, we can be assured that God is present with us through all of life's joys and struggles, and hills and valleys as well. I have to believe that even if and when we don't get the answers that we think we want or think that we need, that Jesus is always there asking us, "What do you want me to do for you?" And listening to our answers, and then living with us us as we figure all of that out, as we journey through all of it, even the suffering. And despite my inclination to maybe be a little bit of an Eeyore or Job sometimes and complain or whine or even curse at God, I look at Job's persistence, even his stubbornness, and definitely his faithfulness amidst his questions and struggles as a gift, as something that encourages me along my journey as well. These are not stories today that give us a lot of answers. I'm sorry. But hopefully, they give us some encouragement and some hope and, again, some companions to walk with us, in each other, in these ancient texts, in this church, and in our life. And so I continue to pray that we find that hope and that we continue to be persistent along the way, and that we continue to nudge and poke at Jesus, asking and answering what we want Jesus to do for us and how we need God to be with us through all of it. Let us pray. We come to you with questions, O God. Sometimes they're specific. Sometimes we demand answers. And yet often our questions are rhetorical, questions that we simply want to have you hear and listen to, wonderings in which we wish that you will join us. Why is there pain in the world? Why do some people suffer? Will injustice ever end? Is there hope for tomorrow? Through all of this, we hear you ask us another question. What do you want me to do for you? And we are at times hard-pressed for the answer. Most of all, O God, we simply want your presence to be made manifest and to be felt in all the corners of our world. For any who wait in frantic hope, may there be assurance that you do not pass by. For any who have needs too great for words, may they be assured that you hear the sighs that are too deep for words. For any who are struggling with day-to-day problems, may there be assurance that you are in that struggle. And through it all, O God, may we follow you in real and certain hope that you would hold the key to new and everlasting life. We pause now, O God, in some silence as we rest in you and as we ask you to hold all of those who are on our prayer list today, those who are on our hearts and minds, and we ask that you hear our deepest prayers for ourselves as well. Help us to know, O God, that you struggle with us. Help us to know, O God, that you hear us and that you receive and hold our questions with deep love and grace. We pray as your church and your people, and we say together, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I am tired.
We hear the call of Jesus to follow. We hear the call of Jesus to care. May God bless our gifts and our giving and the ministries and missions and people they support.
Thank you.
Friends cry out to be heard, giving voice to yours and other needs. In all you say and do, seek the kindness of Christ. In all you say and do, seek the kindness of Christ and follow with your whole heart. Be filled and led by the Spirit into the daily challenges of life, by Spirit's rare and enduring beauty. Go in peace and live in wholeness, now and always. Amen.